So Brighton Bears and the Sussex Bears. I'm going to be here with Gary Smith and Ricky Perrin from Sussex Bears. You're both directors, aren't you? And we'll talk a little bit about the campaign with the Brighton Bears returning. Ricky, maybe first, just briefly, I know we've mentioned it before, and then we'll talk a bit about basketball.
We are on a mission to bring the Bears back to Brighton.
Yeah.
That is what we're doing at our club. We want to bring it back to the community, bring it back to the city. We want to give the same opportunities for the people that live in this city and Sussex that they get further up and down the country.
You know,
and we are going full steam ahead with every plan that we can do to get the council, to get sponsors, to get the community, to get people on board with us.
Yeah, and this is, we're talking about Blackrock as a potential site. It's kind of, I know you've been involved in basketball a lot, Gary. Is it a good site, Blackrock there? Near the coast, isn't it? Can't be too bad.
Exactly. At the end of the day, it's a nice spot, I would say. It's a nice area to develop.
Yeah.
Is there, we're looking at, putting an arena there, which would be great. Yes, it's an ideal spot. At the end of the day, we're in Brighton.
Yeah.
So it's not, I remember when it was, when Brighton Bears were here, the away teams used to turn up and we're happy to be here. We're playing Brighton, because it's a nice place. It's on the south coast, and it was even better when the away team, say, Leicester Riders would come down here. I remember one occasion they came down and they got down here a couple of hours early.
Yeah.
And the players decided to go for a swim. I'm sorry.
Exactly.
Great. And they turned up to the game, and of course they've just come from a swim. They were cold. They weren't ready. We ended up winning the game.
Yeah.
So things like that, it helps.
And culture-wise, how do we get that culture that they have in the States of basketball? Because is it the number one? What is it, NFL or basketball?
Basketball is the number one.
It is the number one. Yeah. And obviously they're on massive salaries there. Mm-hmm. So how do you get that culture in the UK when you're competing against football, cricket, rugby?
It's a simple thing.
Yeah.
And what it is getting in the schools, getting into the community, working with these young kids from primary school, working with the primary schools from primary age, where they get the passion, they get the feel of wanting, I want to play basketball. That's the only difference. That's what America's had for however many years.
Yeah.
Players, it's the same with, when my son, he's 18 now, but when he was born, he had football in his cot.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it was that trend, and he played football right up until the age of 13, 14, and then he decided, actually, I'd like to play basketball. And that's all it is. It's just, what I would say is this, though, is giving them multiple sports to play, from an early age, and basketball being one of them.
Yeah.
The culture will change. But if we're only giving them a football, if we're only giving a child a football, the passion is going to go with football up until the age of 14, 15, 16.
Exactly. When did you first get involved in basketball, Ricky?
So I was injured. I had a spinal injury in 2006. Yeah. And at the time, I didn't really know what wheelchair basketball was. And then I started getting these messages from someone saying, come and play some wheelchair basketball. About 4 years later, went along to training, and I never missed a training session afterwards. Just the freedom of being on the court, the freedom of being able to push your sports wheelchair without any curbs or steps or anything else. It was just a complete life changer. And everything I do now is to try and make that pathway here for the next person who's injured or the next child that's born with a disability. If we can put these things together now, if we can put the pathway in, if we can connect up to universities and schools, we can get these kids to get into it earlier than I did. We can get them fitter and stronger and healthier and active, reduce their mental health problems that could come along as well.
What about access? Because football's fairly easy here, right? You get on a field, mm-hmm. two bags, goal.
Yeah, that's true.
Right?
Yeah.
It's more difficult basketball, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah, okay.
It's now true, isn't it?
It's true. Yeah. It's 100%. Yeah. Now it isn't as difficult as what it used to be when I was growing up, if that makes any sense. We are in a time where there are more basketball courts. We've got a basketball court on the seafront, which, up until about 4 or 5 years ago, it was one of the top outdoor basketball courts in Europe.
Yeah.
You know, you could find the Brighton outdoor court on PlayStation, on a PlayStation game.
Right.
Okay. So we were one of the top.
Really? And
yes. Right. Yeah. So it's what I'm trying to say is there are more basketball courts out there now. In my day, when I was coming up, I was 12, 13 years old. I was 13 years old when I started to play basketball. We had I'm from Birmingham, a Brummie.
Yeah.
So we had one basketball court in that my area. So the rest of the times, what we used to do is play on, you know, you have the lamppost and then you've got that bit sticking out the side. So we'd play on the street and whoever was able to hit that bit sticking out the side of the lamppost, that was the goal.
Yeah,
that was the basket. Yeah, you know, and that's how, you know, I did that for about, two to 3 years. That was it, do you know what I mean? Until I got that break where I was able to sign my contract at 16.
Yeah, and what are the programs like in Sussex? And how do you get basketball courts up and running? Because you need a bit more, well, not that much space, but you need a court. I mean, you can't really do it on grass. It has to be tarmac.
It's got to be tarmac. It's got to be a solid ground. But I mean, there are more now, a lot more.
Right.
And if you was to say go onto Google Earth and look at Newcastle, they've got loads of basketball courts all over the place. You go on Court Finder website, put in Newcastle, there are pop-ups everywhere. It will pop up on Google all over the place. And that's because they've built the infrastructure there around the club. If we bring the Brighton Bears back to Brighton, you'll be surprised how many plots of empty concrete that will turn into basketball courts.
Yeah.
Because people will invest in it. You know, youth clubs will invest in having an outside court.
Yeah.
The beach will always be up, running and being used. You know, car parks that aren't used. I know that, you know, we're trying to get cars out of Brighton. Well, there may be some empty concrete car parks that we can turn into courts.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of funding streams that are available to refurbish courts as well and to get them up and running and in
use. Who funds that then? Is that coming through the Sport England or...?
OK, it's... Basketball England has a project right now. It's called, you know, Project Outdoors, I think it's called. And what they do is we have to find a site. If we are able to find a site, they will fund the basketball court.
Yeah.
And they're doing that. These basketball courts are popping up all over the country now. Yet to pop up down here, because we have quite a few down here. But like I've said, you know, we get the Bears back into the town, those things will then develop. We will then have those things put in place.
Yeah. And do you think, I mean, I've got this here, this programme, do you think we can get people like Dennis Rodman? I mean, do the NBA stars, do they come back and play in England or where do they tend to go? Okay. Do they stay in America? What happens there?
What usually happens is they retire, like Dennis did. Dennis had been retired for, I would like to say, about five to 6 years. So he was already retired, hadn't played any basketball. Nick got in touch with him.
Yep.
And with his agent, should I say.
Yeah.
And they proposed a deal and boom, that's how they got him over here.
He's still good for the free games?
Oh, for the free games, he did well because what happened was it's with Dennis Rodman. So all of a sudden those, you know, the tickets were sold, the games were packed out, everyone wanted to see Dennis Rodman. And they were able to see Dennis Rodman. And by all accounts, he was the nicest guy, nicest person out there.
Yeah, so we need to get those stars coming over then. So it's not as common then. Just before we finish up, I mean, with the Brighton Bears return to Brighton, how do we, how do people get into contact? What do we need to do next? I know I spoke to Ricky previously about working with Brighton City Council. I mean, what else can we do to bring Brighton Bears back to Brighton?
Just encouragement, really and truly. At the end of the day, if you know, on our Facebook page, our Instagram page, and you put messages that on there, that would be great. That always helps. We need to know that, you know, the people of Brighton, the young people of Brighton, etc., actually do want the Bears back. And I'm pretty sure they do because from what I've heard from a lot of people who've gotten in contact with myself and with the club, this is, you know, it's a great move. It's something which they didn't realise would happen. So.
Brilliant. All right, leave it there. Thanks for coming today. Thanks again. All the best and we'll catch up again soon. Cheers.
Thank you.
No worries.
Thanks.